have a good afternoon.
Thank you, Shreyas. Good afternoon, everyone. Before I broadly introduce the topic, which is, of course, data privacy protection and public data, and also our speakers and what we'll be talking about today, I'll take this opportunity to break a bit of news, which was told to me by Srinivas Kodali. The BN Shri Krishna Committee of Experts is going to be giving its report today at 4 p.m., we are told. So those of you who are expecting to work on it, your weekend has been ruined. Congratulations. But anyway, on that note, let me just talk a little bit about what this session is all going to be all about, what our speakers are going to be talking about, and why this is relevant. Those of you who are aware of the debate going on about privacy, you would have noticed that a lot of the discussion about privacy in India is happening largely on two axes. One, what is our right of privacy against the government? When I say our, I mean citizens, individuals, persons of all sorts. What is our right of privacy against the government? To an extent, a lot of that debate has gone on. We have fairly settled principles. We have understood what we can and cannot claim against the government. A second axis of that debate has been, what is our right of privacy against companies who have our data? You know, entities whom we give our data to in some sort of contractual duty, in some sort of commercial consideration, for some sort of commercial consideration, what are our obligations? That is still developing, that is still ongoing, that is still something that is developing as we go on. You know, there are various issues there as well. But there is a third axis to that debate, and something that is most fascinating and very underexplored. It has an impact on the other two axes as well, because there are principles that you will realize that have a bearing on how everybody gets to deal with data and how everybody deals with privacy as a whole. And that is, how do we deal with each other's claims to privacy? Can I claim a right to privacy against you? Can you ask me for my data? And when I say you and me, I literally mean individuals. Can you all, as a group, as a society, as an organization, as public at large, ask me for some details? Can I demand to know something about all of you as an individual, as a researcher, as a lawyer, or something? This is something that is going to keep coming up again and again in many contexts. We have with us two speakers who will illustrate some of the important points that are going to come up in these debates. Through two different contexts. Jyoti is going to speak to us. Jyoti Pandey is going to speak to us about this particular debate in the context of the right to be forgotten. Some of you may have heard of this in the context of the EU and Google, but Jyoti is going to tell you about how this is a much wider debate that is going on around the world and even in India as well. She's going to talk to you about the various implications of this right, when it can be claimed, when it can't. The second speaker is Sushant Sinha. He's the founder of a wonderful website called Indian Kanun. I say that as a lawyer because for most of us lawyers, Sushant is like the Wizard of Oz. We all use Indian Kanun as this amazing website which provides us information about cases which most people didn't have access to unless they were willing to fork over very large amounts of money to a few monopolies. But Sushant has sort of broken a lot of those. And most people are shocked to find out that Indian Kanun is run by this one guy in Bangalore. And you know, it's like a real Wizard of Oz moment for a lot of us to know that all it really just took was this one guy writing code in Bangalore to break a duopoly, really, in the field of law and legal reporting. But this has come with its own problems. And I will leave it to Sushant to explain more in detail the kind of issues that can happen when you put data which is ostensibly public out into the public domain. And why that these are two different things is something I will leave Sushant to discuss and describe. And it's a fascinating experience that he has had over the last few years running Indian Kanun as well. So without any further ado, let me first introduce Jyoti Pandey. She's an independent tech policy researcher. She has previously worked with the Electronic Freedom Frontiers and with the Center for Internet and Society. And she will be speaking to you about the battle for privacy and the right to be forgotten. So over to you, Jyoti.
Thanks, Alok. Good afternoon. I'm Jyoti Pandey. As Alok mentioned, I'm an independent researcher working in tech policy for not very long, just 4 years now. So I'll be talking about right to be forgotten. But before I start on this very interesting topic. I just want to know how many of you use Twitter over here. Can we have a show of hands, please? Great. So everybody's aware of how Twitter throws up these lovely examples of how we deal and interact with technology, right? So let me give you a really interesting story. So 2 weeks back or 3 weeks back, a hashtag called Plain Bay and Pretty Plain Girl started trending on Twitter. So the story goes like this. Rosie Blair, a woman, was traveling with her boyfriend and she wanted to sit. They had different seats, so she wanted to sit with her boyfriend and she convinced this stranger to swap seats with her. This happens with us on a fairly regular basis. What happened next is the interesting part of how technology mediates our interactions with each other. So the girl who swapped her seat for Rosie ended up sitting next to another good-looking man, and it turns out that these two strangers had a lot of things in common. They were both into fitness, they were both cute, they got along, and Rosie continued to talk about this. She went on to tweet and take pictures of this interaction, and initially everybody thought that, you know, this is really adorable, you know, chance encounter, strangers meeting, how very cute. But then Rosie took it a step forward. She started reporting on their conversations. Every elbow touch, every photograph being exchanged was being tweeted. And of course, these tweets went viral because what do we do on Twitter? We follow these strange stories. So, during the time that this interaction was unfolding, people on Twitter started reacting in very different ways. Some people felt that this was meet cute and this is perfect and this is exactly what social media was created for. Other people started noticing that this could be creepy behavior because the girl had not consented to being recorded in this manner and having her interaction being projected to the world. And of course, Rosie knew that there would be some privacy implications because even in the pictures that she was tweeting about these two strangers, she had blurred their faces. So what does this, and it doesn't stop here. At one point, these two strangers got up at the same time, and Rosie went on to speculate that they may be hooking up in the bathroom, which is, of course, uncalled for, and no, it was just that, speculation. So what went on, as the tweets went viral, of course, everybody involved in this incident got really famous, with TV news channels trying to get them into their studios, and Rosie, her boyfriend, and the man all enjoyed the attention and regularly went on the TV circuit gathering the attention and loving it. The girl did not want to be a part of it, but that did not stop a bunch of other internet strangers from trying to hack her identity to figure out who this anonymous, pretty plain girl was. So what does this story tell us about the attention economy? It's the perfect example of how scattered moments presented without context are becoming more and more rampant as we interact on these platforms. People build detailed but very selective profiles of us based on the angle and the interest that they are coming from. Oversharing, intruding, and exploiting others for content is actually rewarded in this economy. So the reason I started with this story is because when we talk about a right to be forgotten, it is important to understand why there is a need for such a right in the first place. And like this story demonstrates, there are many examples where we might not want a certain representation of ourselves online. And should we then have the power to control it? Or is it fair to let others decide for us how they should think about us just by the fact that we have consented to be on the same platform as them? So the right to be forgotten, look at this man. He's Mario Costeja Gonzalez, and he is single-handedly responsible for the right to be forgotten. There's another interesting story here, and this is the most interesting part of my presentation. It's all numbers and words, so just, you know, be awake now. So in 2009, Mario Googled himself, and he was very surprised to see search results throw up a reference to public debt he owed, which led to his house being auctioned. And the laws in Spain, he is from Spain, and the laws in Spain require publications that are to issue a notice for such an auction to attract bidders. This happened a few years back, and when he was Googling himself in 2009, the debt had been cancelled and the auction was no longer relevant. So he felt that, you know, when you type his name in that search and with this reference coming up, it was hampering his reputation. So he approached the publication in question and asked them to. So what had happened was this publication had recently been digitized. And so he approached the publication and said, hey, could you remove it because it is no longer relevant? The publication said, no, sorry, can't do. The law requires us to publish it. This is in the public interest. So then he approached Google, and Google said, of course, we're not going to do. We can't do this. We don't meddle with the content. We just, you know, link to stuff. We don't publish. He then approached the court, and the courts in Spain granted him the right to seek that Google delist the search results so that when somebody types his name, those references don't come up. Google appealed, and the case went up to the European Court of Justice, which again held that yes, he did have the right to be forgotten. The Spain ruling in this case was limited. It said that search engine operators are controllers of personal data. So in data process, you have data processors and you have data controllers. So this was really interesting because the ECJ interpreted search engine operators to be controllers of personal data, and it granted individuals to the right to seek the, to approach the search engines and seek that they delist URLs about them. Personal data was the main stake here. Search results, when you type somebody's name, and if that name comes up in the search result, that should be removed. And the information which is, and because in the Costeja case, the argument relied on the fact that at the time of when the publication published this order for the auction, it was relevant. But 10 or 15 years down the line, it was no longer relevant, and yet it was tied to his reputation. So the idea of relevance was very important in this case. So the court went into some detail and said that information that is outdated, inaccurate, inadequate, irrelevant, devoid of purpose, and no public interest could form the basis of these right to be forgotten requests. Now, where did the court come up with this right? So Europe has really strong privacy protections. I mean, of course, I hope everybody in this room knows that we do not have a privacy law. But Europe has a codified law. In 1995, interestingly, they were trying to update the European directive. And the conversations of right to be forgotten were already taking place in these discussions to update the data protection regime. And parallel to this, out of the blue, the European Court of Justice decides that, yes, there is a right indeed. But for them to be able to grant this right, it must come from somewhere. And they found that right to be forgotten to be a part of data protection regime that existed in Europe at that point, which is the right of erasure. The right of erasure, interestingly, applied only to proprietary databases. So, for example, if you signed up in the 90s, you signed up for a magazine brochure and you stop subscribing, then you can write to that person, be like, hey, I am not accessing your services anymore. Please get rid of my personal details. It did not apply to search databases. The right to be forgotten extended the right to erasure and brought it onto the digital platform. So the right to be forgotten, of course, throws some really interesting questions. It also points to a very important philosophical divide, where we believe that any information, once it's out on the internet, should not be taken back. It should not be tampered because it is out there in the public, if it is lawful and if it is correct. What right to be forgotten does, it creates the mechanism to take lawful, correct, truthful information and judge it on the basis of relevance, which of course is driven by context. So you can see how this right could be open to misinterpretation or really broad interpretations, and that is exactly what is happening. So the European Court of Justice, their rulings apply to all European countries, and of course, following the Spain ruling, there was a trickle effect, and countries started, you know, folding and looking at how they could bring this right for their citizens. So there are very many interesting examples here. So this slide looks only, I'm sorry for the font being so tiny, but I wanted to kind of give a broad view of how fragmented this one right is within the same jurisdiction that already has a common and somewhat strong sense of privacy and data protection. So in Spain, because I said relevance and truthfulness were, the Spain decision made a distinction that with passage of time, newsworthiness diminishes, which was the case because the order was no longer relevant. Netherlands, the Court of Appeal, a similar case came up, and they said that if it's a criminal, the criminal records continue to be relevant no matter how much time has elapsed. So the time factor then contributes to relevance. And as we know with any kind of right, you know, how it is interpreted by the courts and how they define the parameters around it is how it develops. In Spain again, initially the 2014 judgment only applied to search engines. In 2018 recently, they have expanded it to apply to search databases of newspapers and archives. So already the scope of the right has spilled over from search engines and gotten infused with newspapers and archives. In Italy, interestingly, there is a conflict where data protection is being used in a way to stifle journalism. And I'll draw out more of this tension later in the talk. But the Italy example is specifically interesting because here the journalists usually have an exception because there's a public interest, you know, for news being available in the public records, and most laws that, you know, give you control over information always have this balancing test. So in the UK, for example, if somebody goes and says there's a right to be forgotten and I want to exercise this right, the journalist can claim this public interest exception and say, no, this is in the public interest and we'll continue publishing. In Italy, the data protection regime does not apply, this exception does not apply to journalists. And therefore, the one of the many consequences of the legislation and how the national framework is that the right to be forgotten has trumped. So the right to privacy has trumped the right for maintaining public records in that jurisdiction. Again, Germany dealt with the question of, so a lot of criminal, and the courts have been really clear that, you know, if you have been convicted or if there is some sort of a criminal record, then there makes it makes sense for the public to have knowledge of that record because it somehow relates to your reputation and how they should be judging you. Italy, again, what it did establish was that if there is negative publicity, now, so the negative publicity was also something that Costeja argued for. He said that, you know, the links appearing were hampering his reputation. So Italy, again, so basically the way the right to be forgotten has been interpreted in Italy, it essentially translates into that any kind of inconvenient review, or if you write like something about me that I do not like, and even if it is published in a newspaper, I can exercise a right to be forgotten and have it removed from the public records. So you can imagine in the hands of the powerful and the mighty, what a great censorship tool this will be. In France, so another interesting thing that the Spain judgment did and a couple of other jurisdictions have also replicated is specify exclusion protocols that the search engines can use in order to specify to so the publishers should use these exclusion protocols to specify to search engines certain content that they that should be excluded from their automatic indexes. And this is something, so in the Italy decision, this was argued in the court, and the judges completely ignored that, you know, this technical possibility to exclude this search result existed. They went with the broader application of the right. So if you notice, I haven't included UK over here, even though it's part of EU, because I have two very interesting examples that I wanted to bring up. The first is there's a man convicted of benefits fraud in 2012. He forged documents as proof of his innocence, went to Google and said that there are some 300 URLs, please delete. And Google complied with that request and deleted 293 URLs. This guy was so confident. He went again and saw delisting of other links, which were for a conviction for forgery, which is when somebody in Google realized that, oh, hey, wait a minute, if he's been convicted for forgery, maybe the identity documents he showed for the first request could also be forged. And that is exactly what it was. And then they revoked it. So, but the why this is extremely interesting is because even though we trust Google, which is a huge private platform, to create a verification mechanism which would be strong, and they would have resources to, you know, dedicate to this process, had this guy not been greedy and had he not sought delisting of those other links, they would have never found the first the error. So the scope for fraud and the scope for dishonest application of the right to be forgotten is very, very high, even in a country like UK. So we can imagine if this right is exported to India, what is going to happen. The other thing that I wanted to point out is that we have three kinds of broad action happening on the right to be forgotten. So you have the European courts. So you have the courts that are interpreting and reading this right into existing data protection frameworks that are there at the national level. You have some countries that are actually introducing or revising their existing laws and actually incorporating a clause that says, hey, there is a right to be forgotten. So if India comes up with a right to privacy, the chances are pretty high that it would include a mention of the right to be forgotten, if not a specific right. But the third more interesting way this right is being negotiated is through data protection authorities who themselves are interpreting this right and giving it to citizens. So so basically, because EU has already interpreted this right exists, the data protection authorities are then now fining Google for saying, so in the UK, a former bank clerk imprisoned for stealing money from elderly people's bank accounts was convicted. And the data protection authority actually ordered Google, because remember, we are saying that, you know, convicted criminals, their records should be there for the public record. But here the data protection authority went above that standard and actually ordered Google to remove conviction records. So what is happening in North America? This has spread, of course. It has not been limited to European Union. The US does not have a law. There is a bill which is currently being reviewed. It's in the second stage. It's the second time it is being reviewed. California has something called the Eraser Law for minors, which seals juvenile internet records. So these are both legislative things. The courts haven't really dealt with the right to be forgotten in the US yet. In Canada, which is a very interesting example, the courts have, the Data Protection Authority, like I mentioned, has come up with a report based on a consultation independently. So proactively, the data protection authority there is seeking to bring in a right to be forgotten for Canada. And they have recommended that instead of de-indexing a link, lower the rank of a search result. So essentially make it really hard to find. They also have, the Canadian courts have also specified that search engines to use geo-identifying technologies to actively block Canadians from accessing the right to be forgotten link anywhere. So in Canada, the Supreme Court, and more recently, the Supreme Court had a ruling in Equistec where it upheld that Google should remove search results for specific websites, not just in Canada, but everywhere in the world. So the Equistec case has got nothing to do with the right to be forgotten. But it's got to do with how Google implements its removal of search results, and it's the extraterritorial application of one kind of content removal practice from Google that Google practices, and this would have implications for how right to be forgotten is also interpreted. So if Canada may now, building on this decision, be like, hey, not only geo-identifying technology should block Canadians accessing that link within Canada, but make sure that, you know, this link is not available to any Canadian anywhere in the world, which essentially means that, you know, you're tweaking laws of other countries. In Mexico, again, the scope of right to be forgotten has been broadened. There's actually a legislative effort in Mexico on to introduce this right. So again, we see the trend that a lot of powerful people are using this right, you know, to negotiate their reputations online. And of course, when you create a tool like that, who would have the time, the scope, the resources, and the energy to, you know, utilize it to the maximum? And we need to think about these things when we consider certain rights. So this transportation mogul, so it's got nothing to do with the right to be forgotten. But the Data Protection Authority, again, went well above and beyond the scope that has been defined for this right, and suggested and has initiated sanctions against the search engine for cancellation and opposition to the processing of data. So, you know, again, there's this conflict. Is the search engine a controller and therefore has to comply with the right to be forgotten request? And then what Mexico is doing, not only a controller, even if you're processing, you have to still comply with right to be forgotten request. And that is really tricky because we'll come to that later. Anyway, so the courts annulled the DPA order to remove links. In another case, the courts in Mexico have annulled the DPA order. So the DPA is really overreaching in Mexico. And in another case, the court has ruled that when persistence causes injury, right to be forgotten request must be honored. But injury can be open to interpretation. So in Asia, what's happening? Indonesia is the first country in Asia to actually adopt a right to be forgotten law by revising the electronic information and transactions law. Japan, the courts have rejected the existence of such a right. They said that it can only be allowed when the value of privacy protection clearly outweighs that of information disclosure. China too has concluded that there is no right to be forgotten under Chinese laws. It also specifically noted in the case that autocomplete search words did not infringe the complainant's right to his name and reputation. So if I type, is Jyoti Pandey, and if it says a fool, then, you know, I can't be like, hey, Google, you're calling me a fool. So, I mean, it's really interesting how and in which context these cases are also coming up in each of these jurisdictions. So, you know, we have criminal cases, we have the powerful who want to protect their reputation, we have people who are, you know, involved in crimes but were not convicted, we have people who want to transform public records. In South America, I've taken only three countries, but there are a lot of countries actually in South America that are contemplating or actually trying to work with this right. The highest constitutional court refused to recognize right to be forgotten and held that newspaper was not required to remove the report about a woman involved in crime but not convicted, as I just gave that example. They did, however, say that, you know, the publication would have to use exclusion protocols. In Peru, the court has ordered newspapers to remove links to investigations on drug trafficking carried out by law enforcement. And so there is another tension that is developing where public officials and people who hold important offices, certain information about them should be in the public because, you know, they hold these important offices. The right to be forgotten is also negotiating those standards or actually watering them down. In Brazil, there is a case pending where in 1958, a woman was murdered. And in 2004, this major TV network made a show on it. And then one of the relatives of that woman has gone and sued and said that there is a right to be forgotten. You need to remove that. The Supreme Court just held that search engines need to scrub news stories about fraud involving appointment of woman as state judge. So the woman basically became a judge through fraudulent means, and this was reported, and now the courts have in Brazil ruled that, you know, this judge has the right to be forgotten, though as a public official she probably shouldn't. So right to be forgotten in India, what's happening here? And Shashant Sinha in his next talk is going to be covering a lot of this. But as Alok mentioned, we have the Shri Krishna Committee report, and it'll be exciting to see what they actually say. Because in their white paper, they mention a sector. They have mentioned right to be forgotten, and they mention taking a sectoral approach to it, which balances free speech and privacy. It's a very broad mention of the right. They haven't gotten into any specific, but they probably mention it because in the privacy judgment that came out, Puttaswamy versus Union of India, in one of the judges, Justice Kaul's opinion, he references this right in a couple of really interesting contexts. So he talks about young children and how they may have put up certain information that they regret and they should have the right to take that back. But we do already have existing laws, you know, for protection of identity. We have juvenile. So India, I mean, what I'm trying to basically explain is that the justification of this right in that opinion could be handled through other existing legislation, which could be tweaked or improved. There is no, the rationale used in the opinion to me don't suggest that we need to introduce a new right, but we'll see how the Shri Krishna Committee has interpreted that. There are three cases that have happened. The Karnataka High Court, personal details of a woman from a published judgment. So divorce cases, and then you want to get remarried and you Google somebody's name and a reference to their divorce proceedings come in. And it's sort of an embarrassment. So families approaching, women's identity, that's a really important issue in India. And usually courts are very favorable towards handing out judgments that seem, privacy conscious about women. In Gujarat, so the Gujarat the case was interesting. The person who approached the court said this judgment was classified as unreportable, and yet one of these online legal forums has gone and published it. So that the judge made the distinction that publishing on an online legal database is not reporting. I mean, but we see how these fine lines and the nuances and the rationales being used to negotiate this right in each jurisdiction is very dependent on the context, the existing laws, and how the courts actually favor privacy versus public interest. So Google has, of course, been at the eye of the storm, and it recently published a report of the implementation of right to be forgotten requests within Europe. So 2.4 million URLs have been requested by Europeans, and it has complied with 43% of these. Combined France, Germany, UK generated 50.6%. And the usage of right to be forgotten varies. Estonia filing most requests per capita, and Greece the least. So again, within Europe, it's a very uneven score. So who is making these requests? The total volume of previously unseen requesters has declined year on year. The vast majority of requests are coming from individuals, especially individuals with a sizable online presence make heavy use of right to be forgotten. Minors, which is what was driving Justice Call's opinion, are only 5% of these total number of requests. And this is despite Google having taken extra efforts to create knowledge about the existence of this right within that age group in EU, because they're mandated to do so. So what categories of information are people wanting to get removed? There are two broad categories: personal information in web directories or social media histories, and legal history included in news archive and government directory pages. The request categories are also pretty, and this is not an exhaustive list. Google, if I would urge you to go through that report, it is pretty interesting, and actually highlights some really good examples from the countries. Personal information in web directories is something that has. So we can see why people are requesting legal history and news. So one broad trend that has developed over the past 4 years of implementing this right, that the personal information that are in directories and social media, those requests have gone down, but the legal history in government pages and news articles have gone up. Google suggests that one of the many reasons for this could be that you have more control, and platforms have stepped up the privacy practices or are giving user more control about the data that they have published on these platforms. So as these practices evolve in the overall digital economy, the requests are falling. So it's an interesting insight that how the overall economy and how we shape it would then reduce the need for such a right to exist in the first place. In terms of news article and government pages, you don't really have any control over them. Once it's published, it's their policy. So those kind of requests have remained pretty stable. The categories of sites, again, the social media content is 13.9, directory and information are 18.8, news sources, government pages, breakup. So what are some of the trends? News-related content increased, social media generally declined, broad variations in categories of sites requested in different countries. In Spain, 10.6% of requested URLs targeting government records may stem from law that mandates government to publish public notifications. The Spanish law to inform missing individuals about a government decision that directly affects them and publish government decisions to absolve an individual from a criminal sentence. So if you've been convicted and your sentence has been changed, then that needs to be published. So when there are these laws that require your personal details to be part of the public pages. These kind of, in those jurisdictions, these requests are pretty high. The requesters in France and Germany were most concerned with information exposed on social media. These variations actually illustrate the challenge of a one-size-fits-all privacy policy. And this is what we're saying, you know, when we say the Europe's right to be forgotten, it's very important that we distinguish that there is, and it should be the case, that the right to be forgotten in India is looks and takes into context the different legislation, the way of working, our bureaucracy, the chances of fraud. If we import the European right into India, we are going to create trouble for ourselves. What does the right to be forgotten actually do? It creates great power for private corporations. It is basically giving them the right to adjudicate on your fundamental rights. It makes them the arbitrator of relevance and legitimacy. Also, interestingly, the Spanish decision created the obligations for a specific class of intermediaries. But now, again, like I said, the scope of this right has been broadened so much that hosts are different from search engines. So Twitter and Facebook would be hosts, and Google is a search engine. Countries are pushing to have hosts also comply with right to be forgotten requests. When private corporations are deciding and thinking about your fundamental rights, they're doing this behind closed doors. You have no control over it. The opaque decision making and compliance will become de facto rules, because if Google, with its scale and resources, sets the standards of the procedure, how they will go about it, it's very likely that other smaller companies will adopt it. Also, interesting challenges that come up: what happens to information that needs to be retained for auditing and technical reasons, and the territorial scope of right to be forgotten. So Canada, for example, use of technologies to block links. Also really interesting, which I haven't mentioned here, is that even the scope beyond personal information, so they're targeting newspapers and archives and not just search engines, it's gone beyond that. But if the definition of databases expands, and if it is really broad, then technically any hosting function or any platform that has a search database, I mean, if you don't define the parameters of the right and it is only specific to databases, I mean, imagine the implications for any kind of service that has a search function built into it. How does right to be forgotten impact press freedom and historical integrity? In many, many ways. Basically, what it is doing is it is putting the right to know in direct conflict with the right to privacy. It also impacts severely what should be considered public record. Do we have the right to go back and revise public records? It's creating a right to alter lawful information that is already in the public domain. It also impacts historical integrity of published work, archives and history. The duty to preserve information for public interest, data about a private individual, could become relevant in the future. So, you know, today Kusteja might not be important, but after this right to be forgotten ruling, my God, his name is so important. I mean, you know, so relevance and context changes, and when we take information off, it's no longer part of the public. The public no longer has access to it, and that is a form of severe censorship. Maintaining public domain requires transparency and accountability, and when we are outsourcing all of this work to private corporations, it would be very difficult to maintain those levels of transparency and accountability. It is also important to distinguish between certain parts of the process. So are we asking the publication to delete the original newspaper article or report, or are we just asking the search engine to delist, or are we asking the search engine to just rank the search results lower? Depending on which course we adopt, the right will develop its own framework and evolve in a different manner. So two interesting examples. I'll wrap up in 5 minutes. So identity theft, fraud and exclusion. After Anand's talk and all of the Aadhaar conversations we've been having, identity theft, fraud and exclusion have been bearing really heavy on my mind. And given the UK examples, it would be interesting and in fact very, very scary to think about such a right being brought in India without having really strong measures for the verification of identity. So Google has, to prevent fraudulent removal requests, the key criteria that Google sets up is the verification of identity. Now imagine as right to be forgotten expands, and if in India it's a really broad right that applies to all sorts of search databases, then how would we ensure that every database that has to comply with the right to be forgotten request is actually following a very strong and robust verification procedure? Fail-proof mechanism for verification can lead to dishonest application, as we saw in the UK example. It also creates scope and incentive for individuals to game the system. So tomorrow, you know, I could commit fraud and then use a right to be forgotten. First, steal somebody's identity, commit a fraud, and then use the right to be forgotten to remove like all traces of that identity. So it would be very, very important to limit this right to a very, very specific narrow context, even if you're thinking about bringing this in to India. The threat of malicious actors spurring deletions. So what is happening? So in Italy and in Europe, you see a lot of cases of bad reviews of restaurants or people who are in the service industry. Now imagine when you give a tool for someone to, I could genuinely have a bad customer experience, but the corporation could, you know, then just seek a, or that individual could just seek a right to be forgotten request and remove those bad reviews. So in this economy, when part of it relies on our attention and part of it relies on the reputation we build, how would the right to be forgotten impact both of those things? Beyond search engines, if right to be forgotten applies to all types of databases that index personal details, it would definitely hinder innovation. Lack of records of transactions in some cases may prevent coordination. For example, if you have blood banks and they want to coordinate and you don't want your name, then it becomes really difficult for you to without those personal details, coordination in public emergencies becomes harder. Financial data fraud, again, removing traces of forgery or convicted people for people who've been convicted for financial fraud would also create challenges. Deletion of data may leave individuals vulnerable, as exclusion from database could lead to access to services being denied. Now tomorrow, if, and I'm hypothetically thinking this, say if India has a right to be forgotten, and but the caveat is that if you exercise your right to be forgotten, you cannot use this service because our service relies on building on your personal details to personalize that service for you. I mean, in which case the right to be forgotten would effectively be a moot right. So tailoring the right for a very specific context, for a very specific class of intermediary, I mean, ideally this right should not exist, but we don't know how that will go. Another interesting example, and there are, and I'm actually thinking through this, and it'd be lovely to hear people in this audience who have more knowledge about blockchain. I have no idea about blockchain and how it works, and I tried reading it. It seemed very, very complicated. But thinking about the idea that you can take back your identity or you can revise records, what happens to technologies like blockchain that rely on decentralized and distributed which rely on permanent tamper-proof records? So who would be the authority that would grant the right to be forgotten request in this context? Who would be the authority or the stakeholder in that chain who would actually implement it? Who would authenticate and verify? How would that impact technologies like blockchain? Transactions cannot be deleted and tampered with the way technology has been designed in blockchain. The right to be forgotten doesn't sit well with this, and it would stymie the development of such solutions. Would it also reduce transparency of transactions? What is happening is a couple of people in Europe have been exploring options. So storing personal data off-chain and storing transactional data on-chain. And I don't understand how that works. But again, from my research on this, what it seems to suggest is that it actually increases the complexity of the system and therefore makes the entire technology open to attack vectors and makes it more vulnerable. So what's the way forward? Resist adoption of right to be forgotten, explore other measures to control personal data, think through procedural fairness, so frameworks like notice and takedown, and if we could create more individual specific rights around the framework that, so copyright law in India has a notice and takedown, the IT Act has a notice and takedown scheme. Could we think about strengthening these existing frameworks? Clear procedures in event of non-compliance, including going to courts. So DPAs should not be able to step in and order Google. The court should be adjudicating. And again, there is a tension there because if ultimately the Data Protection Authority is the regulator for your personal data, then what kind of rights are we granting the regulator with respect to right to be forgotten, which also relates to content? Clarify the role of the data protection authority, creating exceptions for companies that host. So interestingly, the European has a new privacy framework, the European Global Data Protection Regulation, GDPR, and there it includes the right to be forgotten. But again, none of the privacy experts can actually clarify if the right to be forgotten is limited to search engines or if it also applies to hosts, so Twitter and Facebook. And when Europe, where the right actually evolved, is not clear on this issue, when we are importing it into India without our privacy strong frameworks, it's going to be a problem. So I'm leaving you with some questions, and these are questions for me and for you to think over. Does the right to be forgotten solve the issue of countering untruthful or outdated information online? Does the right negatively impact press freedom, archives, public right to know? How can we ensure right to be forgotten does not become a tool for censorship? What are the unintended consequences on fraud and identity theft? Does right to be forgotten encourage a reputation economy? So in UK, France, and Germany, there is interestingly a bunch of corporations that are filing these requests because we have online celebrities that don't have the time to do it. So they are outsourcing it to these companies, and an economy has developed around right to be forgotten. So will we create a similar economy if we export this right here? And how does the right to be forgotten impact development of new technologies like blockchain or other immutable ledgers? Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Jyoti. Since we are running a little bit short on time, so what I suggest is that we take all questions after Sushant's, so that the audience has a full perspective of the issue. So all questions for Jyoti and Sushant, we will take at the end of Sushant's session as well, since that'll be just before lunch and we can go a little bit over time also as required. So please, can we have another round of applause for Jyoti as well?